So in this particular video, we are going to talk about concavity, convexity, and point of inflection. Okay, so these factors are very important for graphing curves, okay, or for tracing curves, Now, let us first understand what do we mean by concavity, convexity, and point of inflection. Let us first go through their mathematical definitions, and then we will be coming to the calculus of those points. Okay. So, basically, suppose we have a plane, XY plane like this, and suppose we have a curve, some y equals to fx, and the curve in an interval x equals to a and x equals to b looks like this. Okay, it is a smooth curve basically, so looks like this. Okay, got it. Let's see. So this is your x equals to a and this is your x equals to b. Now see, if I draw a tangent, if I draw a tangent at any point on the curve in between this interval AB, so suppose I draw a tangent at this point, say x equals to C, I can easily find out that the curve lies above the tangent. This is the tangent and the curve lies above the tangent. When this happens, that the curve lies above the tangent, then this shape is known as convex downwards or concave upwards. Okay. This shape is known as convex downwards or concave upwards. Similarly, if you have a shape just opposite to this, in an interval AB, in an interval x equals to A and x equals to B, where at any point if you draw a tangent, say at this point x equals to C, then you will be able to see that the curve lies below the tangent. This sort of a shape is known as convex upwards or concave downwards. Okay. But if you just, if you want to distinguish each shape on the basis of concavity and convexity, then do remember that convex downwards can be also called simply convex shaped, and concave downwards can be called concave shaped. That is, this shape can also be called concave and this shape can also be called convex. Got it, guys? Now let us talk about the point of inflection. So suppose we have the plane again like this, and this is a curve we have. Carefully notice that suppose we give a point here, let this be x equals to C, and the interval in which the function is defined, let that be x equals to A and its final point is x equals to B. Carefully notice that in the range AC, we have concave shape, and in the range CB, we have convex shape. That is the concavity, or you can write convexity, concavity changes at x equals to c. This point is known as the point of inflection. This point is known as the point of inflection. This point is known as the point of inflection. The point where the concavity or the convexity of the curve changes is known as the point of inflection. Okay. So, now we will be moving on to the theorem of these shapes. So, theorem, what does the theorem say? If at all points in an interval which is closed AB, the second derivative of the curve y equals to fx is positive, then the curve is convex. Okay, then the curve is convex in that interval. That means ki for convexity in the closed interval AB, f double dash x must be greater than 0 for all x belongs to AB. Got it guys? For all x equals to AB. Okay, for convexity, remember, for convexity. Okay, we will prove it later. Similarly, we have that, let me write it here only, let me just modify it and write it here only, that if at all points in interval AB, if at all points in an interval AB, the second derivative of the curve y equals to fx is negative, then the curve is concave in that interval. Okay, so basically f double dash x is less than 0 for all x belongs to AB for concavity. Okay, so these are the two theorems we have. Got it guys? Now we will be proving the theorem. Okay, now we will be proving the theorem. So proof of the theorem is pretty easy. So let's just see the proof. Okay, so let's just go through the proof. So suppose we have an arbitrary plane like this, xy plane, and this is a curve we have, and this curve is defined in the region or in the interval as given in the theorem, x equals to a to x equals to b, and this curve is y equals to fx. Now suppose we, you know, just choose an arbitrary point which is x naught, y naught, and we draw a tangent at that particular point. So we need to show here that the curve lies above this drawn tangent. Let the tangent be represented as y bar equals to say gx. Okay, y bar equals to say gx. So basically these are the setups we require for the proof. Now we move on to the proof. Okay. Slope of the tangent at x naught, y naught can be written as f dash x naught, right? We already know this. Why is this true? We already know this. We have learned the derivative of a function. So from here we can say that that implies that f dash x naught is equals to y naught over y bar by x naught over x. What is y bar? Y bar is any arbitrary point. Y bar is any arbitrary point on the tangent line. Okay. Y bar is any arbitrary point on the tangent line, and x is any arbitrary point on the tangent line. Okay. From here we can say that y naught minus y bar is equals to f dash x naught times x naught minus x. Okay. And from here we can say that y bar is equals to f dash x naught y bar equals to y naught minus f dash x naught times x naught minus x. Okay, pretty clear till this much. Now see, y naught can be written as f of x naught. Y naught can be written as f of x naught, because y naught is a point on the curve y equals to fx also. So this can be written as fx naught minus f dash x naught times x naught minus x. Clear till this much, guys? Okay. Now see, now we do what? We basically make this equation to look like this. Y minus y bar, we basically multiply y bar by a negative sign, and then we add a y to the negative y bar. So this gives us, now what is y? Y can be written as fx. So fx minus fx naught, this will become plus, but we don't make it plus, instead we make it minus f dash x naught times x minus x naught. Okay, we basically brought down a minus from inside of the bracket. From here we can say that, now see, if we apply the Lagrange mean value theorem to this portion of this equation, then what we can say? That this is equals to f dash c times x minus x naught times minus f dash x naught times x minus x naught. And to be mentioned here that c belongs to the interval x naught x. Okay, x naught x. So now what we can do is that we can take the x minus x naught common from here. So by taking x minus x naught common, we have here f dash c minus f dash x naught, right? So from here we can say y minus y bar is equals to x minus x naught. And if we again apply Lagrange mean value theorem to this particular thing, we can write this as f double dash c 1, let's say, times c minus x naught. Okay, we can do this. And again to be mentioned here that c 1 belongs to the interval x naught c. C1 belongs to the interval x naught c. Okay, that is c1 also belongs to the interval x naught x, nothing else. Okay, so c1, they belong to the same interval. I'm just talking here arbitrarily. Okay, now see here. Okay, so therefore, we can say that y minus y bar is equals to x minus x naught times c minus x naught times f double dash c 1. Now let us just go through two cases. So case 1, that is x is greater than x naught. Now, if x is greater than x naught, then what are the points we get? The first point we get that x minus x naught is greater than 0. Second, now if x is greater than x naught, then c is also greater than x naught, because when c belongs to the interval x naught x, okay, where x is the bigger range and x naught is the smaller range. So c, where is c? Okay, c1, we are talking about c1, right? Or no, we are talking about c. So c belongs to any number in between x naught and x. So it will be less than x and greater than x naught. That means ki your c minus x naught is also greater than 0. And if you consider that f double dash c1 is greater than 0, this is your considered. Then what do you get? Then from here you can say that y minus y bar is greater than 0, which indicates that curve is above tangent. Okay. Similarly, you have one more case. Similarly, you have one more case. What is that particular case? In this particular case, you see that basically case 2, you consider here x is less than x naught. When x is less than x naught, x minus x naught is less than 0. X minus x naught is less than 0. Now when x is less than x naught, we can also say that c is less than x naught, because c lies in between x and x naught. So c minus x naught also is less than 0. Now f double dash c1 is considered to be greater than 0. Then if these two are negative, then they multiply to become positive, and this is also positive. That means y minus y bar is still greater than 0, which again indicates that curve is above tangent. Now these are the only two cases that can be formed. So from here we can say that now see, when curve is above tangent, what does that mean? That means convexity of the curve. So from here we can say that convexity is possible in an interval x naught x, as per the proof, if f double dash c1 greater than 0 for all c1 belonging to the curve x naught x. Okay, let me make it the open interval. Okay, now if you replace x naught with a and x with b, you are done, or you don't need to replace it even. Okay, you don't need to replace it even. You can just go through the proof according to this particular thing. So this is what you need. Now if you want to show this proof for the concavity, you just need to go through the same steps. I'm just showing you where you need to make changes. So basically till here it will be exactly same. Here what you will do, this will be correct, this will be correct. Here you need to assume that f double dash c1 is less than 0. So f double dash c1 is less than 0, then this becomes less than 0. If this is less than 0, then curve lies below tangent. Similarly, in case 2, this one's correct, this one's correct. You need to assume this to be less than 0. If this is less than 0, then this becomes less than 0. And if so, then the curve lies below tangent. Thus, concavity is possible in the interval x naught x for all if f dash c1 is less than 0, is less than 0 for all c1 belonging to the interval x naught x. Okay guys, so pretty clear till this much, right? So now we will be talking about the point of inflection. So what happens in the point of inflection there? It is pretty easy to see. Point of inflection. So if f dash x equal to 0 for x equals to c and c belongs to some interval a b, that is not mandatory, that is not some important point here, then x equals to c is the, no, basically then c f c is the point of inflection of the curve y equals to fx. Okay, f dash x needs to be 0 at the point of inflection. So now we will be talking about some important theorems. Okay, the first theorem says that if double dash x equals to f triple dash x, that is the first second derivative equal to the third derivative till the n minus 1th derivative is equals to 0 and the nth derivative is not equals to 0, then the curve y equals to fx is concave or convex at P with respect to x is given according as fnx greater than 0 or fnx less than 0 if n is even and curve has a point of inflection at P if n is odd for x belonging to some interval AB. Okay, so basically what is told here, see, if there is some function f, okay, which is we have considered that it is defined in the interval AB, and we find that its second derivative, third derivative till its n minus 1th derivative, they are all 0, while the nth derivative of that particular function is not 0 for some x belonging to that interval AB, then we can say about the concavity or the convexity of that particular graph y equals to fx accordingly as the nth derivative if less than 0 or if greater than 0, provided that the n is even. And if n is odd, then there is a point of inflection at that particular point. Okay, got it guys? Acha. So this is the theorem we have. So this was all about concavity and convexity guys. In the next lectures, we will be bringing out with some problems on these particular topics, on Leibniz theorem, nth derivative and these sorts of topics. So we will be meeting you in the next lecture.